Madam Radhika Srivastav, Executive Director, FIIB, Faculty of FIIB, members of the management of FIIB, distinguished participants in the two panel discussions, and students of this institution. Let me first of all express my thanks to the Institute and in particular Madam Radhika for inviting me to this very important occasion of the 20th Founders Day. And let me also congratulate FIIB for all the initiatives on sustainability that we saw in the two videos, as well as the fact that it is now a core requirement of the MBA program, and also for making this the theme of this important occasion of the 20th Founders Day. In one of the videos, the first video, some of the students made very, educated guesses about what sustainability is. And I think that most of them got the core idea right. And so let us, in the course of my lecture, explore some of these concepts and ideas a little more. So can we have the first slide? Now, is sustainability a newfangled idea? Did the world suddenly wake up in 1972 in the Stockholm conference and say, aha, we have a problem, and so we must now address this question of sustainability? Well, on the contrary, sustainability considerations, sustainability as a key element of human civilization, has been there since the dawn of human history. And right from the beginning, the fragility of human dependence upon nature has long been recognized by scholars and philosophers, and also has sought to be implemented by rulers, by businesses, by the common citizens. In the 6th century BC, about the same time as Gautam Buddha lived in India, Confucius in China stated that the entirety of human civilization depends upon 6 inches of topsoil and the fact that it rains. Can we recognize the truth of this statement in today's world? Can we see that if there is a serious disruption in the rainfall owing to climate change, human civilization as we know it will cease to exist? Can we understand that if we deplete the natural resource base of the earth, there would be no output, whether of food, whether of industry? So what was said in the 6th century BC is just as true today as it was nearly 3,000 years ago. Now let me turn to one of Buddha's teachings. A story in the Dhammapada tells of how Ananda, who was one of the Buddha's principal disciples, taught the lesson of mindful sharing of one's own wealth and also the earth's resources. And let me tell you the story. There was a kingdom in North India which was ruled by a rather selfish king. But the queen was not selfish. And one day the queen heard that the Buddha was coming into the kingdom to hold a sermon. And she went incognito to the sermon and listened to the Buddha. And then she was so overcome by the sermon, she felt that she must help the Buddha preach his message. So she went to him and gave him a bag of gold and said, "Master, please use this gold for a worthy purpose." And the Buddha gave this bag of gold to Ananda and told him that please use it properly. Now when the king heard of this, he suspected that perhaps Ananda has tricked the queen into parting with that bag of gold. So he summoned Ananda and he said, "Well, I hear the queen has given you a bag of gold, and what are you going to do with it?" So he said, "I will take it to the market and buy as much cloth as I can with this gold." And the king asked, "What will you do with that cloth?" And Ananda replied, "That cloth should be enough for me to make new clothes for 2,000 of the poor people in this kingdom." And the king said, "Well, what will you do with the old clothes?" So Ananda replied, "Well, I will make quilts out of the old clothes." The king asked, "Well, when the quilts are worn away, what will you do with those?" "So I will make them into pillows." He says, "When the pillows have worn away, what will you do with the pillows?" "I will make them into floor rugs." Says, "When the floor rugs are worn away, what will you do with them?" Says, "I will make them into floor mops for cleaning the floors." Said, "When the floor mops are worn away, what will you do with it?" Says, "Then I will tear them into rags, mix them with mud, and use it to plaster the walls of the huts of the poor." And when the king heard this, he immediately understood the message of the Buddha. Use nature's resources frugally and wisely and share your wealth. And I think that is the core message of sustainability that we have to carry with us. Next, please. You can change it from here. Well, all the old religions, all the traditional religions laid a great deal of emphasis on sustainability. The great ancient Indian texts, the Vedas, the Upanishads, and the great mythologies, Mahabharata, Ramayana, they deal extensively with the relationship between man and nature. For example, in the Atharva Veda, the Bhumi Sukta hymn refers to the earth as Vasudha for containing all wealth, Hiranya Vaksha for having gold bosom, and Jagato Niveshini for being the abode of the whole world. She is not for the different races of humankind alone, but for all other living creatures. Let's turn now to the Abrahamic religions. And it is sometimes said that Judaism, Christianity, Islam, that they in some sense preach of man's domination over nature. And in that sense they are distinct from the oriental religions like Buddhism, Hinduism, and of course if you consider Confucianism as a religion. And the framework for Judaism and Christianity's teachings on the environment, they emerge from an apparent tension between two verses at the beginning of Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. It says, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it." And a lot of emphasis has been placed by people on subduing it. Subdue the earth. And have dominion over every living thing. So this passage has been interpreted by many as suggesting that the Abrahamic religions, that they in fact, you know, stand for man's dominion over nature. And God takes the newly created human and placed him in the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and guard it. And this is a contradiction, apparent contradiction from the earlier para. However, Christians point out that the proper interpretation of these two paras is on stewardship, not ownership, and that the earth remains the Lord's. And in the Psalms, 24th Psalm, verse 1, Leviticus states, "The earth must not be sold permanently, because the land is mine, and you are but aliens and my tenants." Land is mine, the land is that of the Lord's, not that of humans. And if the land is not that of humans, humans cannot claim dominion over all that lives on the land. And let us take Islam. The word earth or ard appears 485 times in the Quran Sharif. And the word Sharia, which stands for Islamic law, literally means the source of water. And you must understand that the theme of water runs through the entire Quran. And this is appropriate really to a religion that has originated in the desert. And the Quran also says, in the words of Allah, "There is not an animal in the earth, nor a creature flying on two wings, but they are like you." So the Quran is very clear that there is no real difference between humankind and the rest of nature. Islam forbids the wastage of water and the usage thereof without benefit. The preservation of water for the drinking of mankind, animal life, bird life, and vegetation is a form of worship which gains the pleasure of Allah. So it elevates the conservation of water to a sacred religious duty. So what do we conclude from this part? That traditional societies did not need to be sensitized to the imperative of conversation. And all major religions were strongly conscious of the absolute dependence of humankind on nature. Now let us turn the clock a number of centuries and come to the late 18th century and early 19th century. And at this time, Thomas Malthus, in his very famous essay on population, stated that human populations grow exponentially while food production grows at an arithmetic rate. And this scenario predicts a future when humans would have no resources to survive on. And to avoid such a catastrophe, Malthus urged controls on human population growth. Now clearly Malthus was concerned about the sustainability of the human race. But he was concerned in one particular direction, and that is the differential rates of growth of population would make it impossible to feed so many people from the finite resources of the earth with respect to agriculture. But this was at the beginning of the industrial era. And at this stage, the impact of industrialization upon natural resources was not evident. There was no understanding or knowledge of climate change. There was very little understanding of what mining can do to biodiversity and how the depletion of biodiversity would impact the stability of ecological systems. What was evident at that time is that following the rapid adoption of public health measures as a result of medical discoveries around that time, was that there was a rapid reduction in death rates in the mid-18th century and consequent explosive growth of population. Many of you would have, you know, come across this, that look, the developing countries and particularly India and large developing countries, their population is increasing at an extremely rapid rate. But this phenomenon of death rates going down and birth rates remaining the same and only slowly changing is not something which is peculiar to India or the developing countries. It's a historically well-established phenomenon that the death rates fall at the beginning of the industrial era, when a country undergoes industrialization. The birth rates take several decades. In the case of the West, it took several centuries to change. And in that process, there is a rapid explosion of population. Now let's fast forward to the late 20th century and to the present day. How many of you have heard of the Limits to Growth study? Okay, that is Mr. Datta Roy. He would have, of course, heard of it. Anyway, let me tell you something about it, and maybe you can download the study and read it, because it is the most influential study which has had tremendous impact on global and national policy making. And this study actually was originally conducted in 1972. It was updated in 1992 and in 2002. And I think the time has come for the next update. And this study was carried out in the systems dynamics group at the MIT. And it used systems dynamics theory and computer modeling and a lot of science, a lot of technology, a lot of social science to analyze the long-term causes and consequences of growth in the world's population and the material economy, and to answer two questions. Are current policies leading to a sustainable future or to collapse? And second, what can be done to create a human economy that provides sufficiently for all? Because by 1972, as in contrast to Malthus's time, what was clear is that there was of course rapid increase in population globally. But there was also rapid depletion of natural resources. There was rapid depletion of forests. There was widespread contamination of water. There was widespread air pollution. And so the fears were expressed that, look, we cannot carry out with these. All of these are moving in geometric progression. So we cannot carry on in this manner. But exactly what would happen? So I'll now present a few graphs to show what the study results were. And this is a picture of the demographic transition globally. And what we can see is that globally the death rates would fall rapidly from in the 20th century, but that they would start rising again, and this is ominous, and I will come to that in a little while. Now the population would continue to rise, but it would gradually moderate. Birth rates would drop, but there would be a substantial lag of a century between the rapid fall in death rates and the rapid fall in birth rates. And this difference is really what gives rise to this curve of population. So this was the population side of the equation. Now, however, since the study was conducted, the average birth rate has actually fallen considerably faster than the death rate. And in turn, the growth of world population has decreased. And so this curve doesn't look quite like this anymore. It looks something like this. And so the present modeling studies suggest that the global population may stabilize around 2050. And while the original study said it might stabilize at about 10 billion, the present consensus is that it might stabilize at about 8 billion. So that's a significant change that has already happened. And the next set of graphs show how the developing countries, their population would rise, but then they would start falling. And that's not good news, is it? Whereas the industrialized countries, that they would rise till about the 1940s or 50s, when there would be a dip. What is this dip due to?
World Wars,
exactly. And then they would rise again after the World Wars. And what's this rise called?
Baby boom,
exactly, you got it right. And then they would keep gradually falling as fertility rates declined. But then they would actually fall very, very dramatically. Okay? And we see this happening, right? And so the point is that when we come to the year 2100, we've had a collapse of the population of the developing countries from their peak in somewhere around 2000, and then it falls rapidly. But in 2100, the population of developing countries is well above what they were in 1700, well above what they were in the year 1900, well above and around where they were at the mid of the last century. Then let's have a look that if the world goes on as it is doing in what is called scenario 1 or the reference scenario, in which the world proceeds in a business as usual manner without major deviation from the existing policies, then what do we see? That industrial output peaks about now and then it falls. That the availability of natural resources keeps declining. And you know what? The prices of coal, oil, iron ore, minerals, they have been increasing, and that reflects the growing resource scarcity. So we already see that this is happening. That there would be a rise in the pollution, but then the pollution levels would gradually keep coming down. And why would this come down? Partly because more and more countries would adopt pollution control measures, but then also industrial output was also keep falling. And then we have food production, which would peak again about now, and then it would keep falling. So by 2100, the global population would have fallen well below 2000 levels, industrial output would be well below 2000 levels, and so overall, and you know, the resource availability would have declined very substantially. Now let's see what this does to the material standard of living. So if you look at the food per person, we are about at the maximum as of now, and then it declines. So in the year 2100, the food availability per person is less than in 1900. Less than what your great-great-grandfather had. So your great-great-grandkids would have less to eat than your great-great-grandparents. Consumer goods per person. Again, we are at the peak about now, cars per person, clothes per person, mobile phones per person. But then they drop precipitously until in 2100 they are less than in the year 1900. And life expectancy, the global life expectancy is the maximum about now. And then it would gradually go down until in 2100 it is less than in 1900. So which means that three generations from now, the people would be worse off in every relevant respect than people three generations earlier. And this is what happens when we go forward in the manner that we have been doing so far. Is all this good news for business? Nobody seems to know. It's not. Is that a very firm no, or is that a very tentative no? It's okay. It's a firm no. And we have the human welfare index, again it has the same thing, okay? But let's see. It's not a pessimistic story, because we can change the way we are going. And of course the study does a number of scenarios. It simulates various assumptions about societal behavior, about industrial behavior, about governmental behavior and so on. But then it comes to scenario 9, which the authors term a sustainable scenario. And in this scenario, the world seeks stable population and stable industrial growth per person, output per person, together with controls over pollution, resource conservation, and agricultural technologies from about the year 2002. So we are a little late. So let's see what happens. And what we see is that resource availability declines, but doesn't decline as sharply. That industrial output stabilizes, but it is well above the level that it was in 2000, as well as in 1990. That pollution peaks around mid-century, but then comes down very substantially. And we see the material standard of living continues to, well, there are some hiccups, but ultimately we are much better off in 2100 than in 1900. That life expectancy increases and remains high, and the human welfare index increases and remains high, and the human ecological footprint peaks about now and then it declines. So this is the optimistic picture. It is not a picture of constantly increasing material consumption per person. It's a picture of a fairly high but stable level of material consumption, resource use, low pollution, high life expectancy, and high welfare for individuals. Now that's good news for business, isn't it? Now this is what I have to say. The corporate sector has collectively the greatest stake in ensuring that the world moves to sustainability, that is scenario 9, rather than remaining imprisoned in the business as usual scenario, which is scenario 1. Do you agree with this? Falling industrial production, falling human welfare, not good for business, right? And the corporate sector has also the largest role in enabling this to happen. So the corporate sector can't say, well, let the government take care of it. Let the communities take care of it. Maybe I'll take care of it in my individual context, and that is very important. But all that is not enough, because the biggest ecological footprint is that, collectively, that of the corporate sector. And when I say that the world has to restructure for sustainability, I'm not singling out the corporate sector. It has to be done by the corporate sector, it has to be done by the governments, by the communities, by all the individuals. But these are some general principles that all must follow. First, extend the planning horizon. Base the choice among current technology options on their long-term benefits and costs rather than short-term profitability. Can somebody give an example of how this could be done? One concrete example. Anyone analyzed the economic net benefit of a compact fluorescent lamp versus an incandescent lamp? You've done that? Right? This is a very small example of what is meant. Okay? The upfront cost of a compact fluorescent lamp is maybe 8 or 10 times that of the incandescent lamp, but over its lifetime it has a much lower energy footprint for the same service, and it has a much lower overall cost of providing the same service. Improve signals. Learn and monitor the real effects of welfare of human societies and world ecosystems of human activity. Last week I had gone to Chandigarh to discuss with senior officials of the Punjab government about the sustainability concerns that the state faced. And they said, well, we have a very serious problem related to cultivation of rice. And they say there's a huge amount of acreage in Punjab which is dedicated to rice. And Punjab is not a high rainfall state. The traditional rice growing areas are in the high rainfall states. So why is Punjab growing all that rice? Because of certain policies. Because the Punjab government gives free electricity to the farmers. And they can go down as deep as possible to extract the groundwater. So they go down 300 meters, 500 meters. They keep going. It gets depleted in one aquifer, they go to the next aquifer. It gets depleted, go to the next aquifer. So this is a policy which was meant to encourage farmers, but it ended up making it all but certain that if there's a real drought, people in Punjab will have a great deal of difficulty. But another thing happens. All that paddy yields a lot of straw, and the straw is very high in silica content. And when it is so high in silica content, you can't burn it in boilers. So what do the farmers do? They burn it in the open. And when they burn it in the open, what do you think happens? All over Delhi and NCR, right after the harvesting season, right after around Diwali, you see a huge, huge amount of pollution. And what does it do to the health of you and me and the people of Punjab? One mistaken policy, giving free electricity to the farmers of Punjab, has caused this disaster. Speed up response times. Forecast and decide in advance what to do if the environment and society is stressed. So in the NCR, successive governments have taken credit for building flyovers and then double-deck flyovers, and which means that every 7 years, we will have to build another story to these flyovers. And so the governments have been encouraging people to travel by cars, or at least not discouraging them. And with the result that the commuting times across the NCR has been steadily increasing. So earlier, you could travel from Gurgaon to Delhi in about little more than half an hour. Now typically it takes 1.5 hours. And what does it do to the level of air pollution in the NCR? What does it do to the wastage of time of valuable human resources? The point is that we need to forecast what would happen if certain policies and actions are taken. Minimize the use of non-renewable resources. Fossil fuels, minerals should be used with the greatest possible efficiency and recycled wherever possible. And I'm so glad that in FIAB you are actually recycling whatever can be recycled. Prevent the erosion of renewable resources. Productivity of soils, surface waters, forests, fisheries, etc. should be restored and enhanced, and harvesting should not exceed the rates of natural regeneration. There are some spelling mistakes, I apologize for them. Use all resources with maximum efficiency. The more human welfare can be obtained with the given ecological footprint, the better will be the quality of life within the limits. And this is the message of the Ananda story. And slow and eventually stop exponential growth of population and physical capital that are desirable and sustainable. Now there are three areas where we have to completely rethink the way our societies are organized. First is poverty. We have to have a fair distribution of resources if the entirety of human society is to willingly participate in the quest for global sustainability. And we see a million revolutions happening around the world. We see the Occupy Wall Street movement. We see all these, the Arab Spring movements. We see currently a near civil war in Ukraine. And ultimately many of them are to be traced to the fact of inequalities that are manifest and increasing in society. Unemployment. Human beings need to work to take responsibility for fulfilling the basic needs, to have the sense of personal participation and to be accepted as responsible members of society. You can give a person a dole, but that person is not going to be happy with the dole. Give him the same wages in paid employment, that's going to lead to much greater welfare. Corporates have to consciously have an employment policy, not minimize the number of people that they employ, though I fully understand that there are perverse labor laws in this country which make it very risky to do so, and we need to work with the governments to change these labor laws. But point is that this is one important aspect of sustainability. Unmet non-material needs. Why do you think somebody buys a BMW? Is it really that he values that level of comfort? Or can he do with a Maruti Desire for the same service? He jolly well can. But he is seeking the esteem of his peers by buying that BMW. And this is foolish. To try and seek esteem, which is a non-material, you know, aspiration through acquiring material goods. Now, briefly, let me look at some sustainability drivers. So these are what the collective, the entirety of human society needs to do. Now let's look at what individual corporates can do. Sustainability drivers, why should corporates adopt sustainability? Regulations, and the government has a lot of regulations, and a number of these have been actually put into practice in India. I won't read these out. Access to finance. You won't get money from a responsible organization unless you have a sustainability code. Expanded consumer base. A number of consumers care about the environmental record and the sustainability record of companies. There was a fire in a Bangladesh textile, garments factory, which resulted in something like 2,000 deaths. And you know what? All the companies which sourced from this factory and generally from Bangladesh, they stopped procurement because they figured out that this fire did not happen, was not entirely an accident, that the fire happened because of unsustainable, unsafe and socially irresponsible practices. And why did the companies do this? Because their consumers were not going to accept the products made from sweated labor. Social license to operate, triple bottom line, you have all heard of that. And essentially, by doing this, companies are able to anticipate future conflicts and assess prospects of expansion, and particularly where the critical resources, that is the airshed, water resources and land, are to be shared with the local community. And we have many examples of this. Then we have innovation. Many companies find that when they are actually trying to accomplish sustainability in their operations, they find solutions to energy, water, conservation and so on. And these lead to greater efficiency and these in fact enhance the bottom line. Reputation. The longest surviving companies, look at the Fortune 500, look at the longest surviving companies in India. They are those with a reputation for ethical conduct. So internationally you have the Rockefellers, in India you have the Tata and the Birla Group, among others. I'm not saying that these are the only ones. And these are the ones which have been there for the better part of for nearly two centuries. And they are perceived as being ethical organizations. A core component in establishing reputation is fairness in dealing with suppliers, customers, local communities, government and the environment. Operational efficiency, and this is again seen very often as a verifiable outcome of corporate sustainability, especially when it comes to the use of the resources. So now let's come to lifting the top line. How would companies actually make money? There are four broad approaches. First, provision of marketable environmental services. How many of you have heard of the Clean Development Mechanism? Okay, some of you have. Good. That's an example of companies getting paid for providing an environmental service. Second is monetizing externality benefits. You clean up a landfill, the surrounding land values appreciate. You collaborate with the municipality so that you share that increased land value. It becomes worthwhile for you to undertake this project to clean up. First mover advantage. Companies which anticipate future regulatory and market environments and move first, adopting new technology, new practices, they are there right in position to catch the ball when the change happens. So in India, for example, you have the Revo car, the Mahindra E2O, they are ahead of their time. But just wait 10 years, 15 years, they will be the kids on the block who are going to really rake in the money when customers switch wholesale from fossil fuels, which would then be priced at $200 per barrel, and then the move to electricity. Realize premiums on green products and services, for example, certified organic produce. You've heard of eco labels. A lot of empirical evidence that customers actually are willing to pay a premium on certified products. And this is another way that the companies can avail of this. So let's come to the final word. And Gandhi said, be the change you want to see in the world. And what did he mean by that? And I want to address this to the MBA students. It is that after you've done your career, made your fortunes, after all your name be programmed to make your fortunes, right? And I hope that, all sincerely hope all of you make your fortunes. But then when you have completed your career and then your grandkids ask you, why is the world so polluted? Where have all the birds gone? Why do we read about the blue sky in the books? Why is there so much poverty? Why is there so much violence? Why is there so much corruption? You should not then have to reply that, sorry, I was so busy making my fortune, I did not notice. Thank you. Yeah, go ahead.
So my question is that from all your varied experiences and the wonderful story that we have heard about sustainability, how would we rate India on the scale of 1 to 5? And is there a difference between the interpretation for sustainability in Western and Eastern nations?
Sorry, what's the last part? Is there a difference?
Is there the interpretation for sustainability in Western and Eastern nations?
Well, how does India rate? A lot depends on, do you look at the absolute or do you look at the picture in terms of the level of development? Now, there is an empirical phenomenon called the environmental Kuznets curve, which says that as a country develops, that is, per capita GDP increases, all environmental parameters worsen, pollution increases, forests get depleted, water gets polluted, and so on. But then at about a per capita income of $6,000 to $8,000 per capita, it starts declining. And then, of course, when the country becomes rich, it's able to put in a lot of resources in environmental management. But in the process, they have actually lost a great deal of their, you know, irreversible environmental damage. For example, they've lost a lot of biodiversity. And you see this in Europe, you see this in North America and so on. What has happened in India is that we see that this kind of a change in terms of, say, water pollution in the major cities, in terms of forest cover, in terms of air pollution levels, that much of this change has happened at a much lower per capita GDP. $3,000 per capita in PPP terms. So much of this change has happened, okay, much earlier. In fact, if you look at the energy intensity of GDP, the change in India, the peaking in India happened around 1985, where our PPP per capita was less than $1,000. Whereas in the case of Japan, one of the most energy efficient countries, it happened around $20,000 per capita. And this is all from figures from the International Energy Agency. So in India, we are certainly not, you know, the levels of air pollution in the NCR are certainly not those that you see in Western capitals. But we are better than they were when they were at our, at our level. And you have to just Google for the Los Angeles smog, for the London smog, and you'll know what I'm talking about. Now, is there a difference in concepts of sustainability? At a deep philosophical level, yes, there certainly is. Because typically, a lot of policy making in the West are dominated by economic concepts of efficiency about, and the way that they see it is in terms of, say, environmental accounting for the GDP. And I'm not saying that that's not a legitimate way to go, but I'm saying that that's not the complete picture. Whereas if you look at the discourse in many developing countries, there is a great deal of concern for a biocentric approach. Essentially, loosely, you may call it the rights of nature. And in the Western philosophical tradition, the concept of right to nature, rights of nature, is somewhat meaningless. In the Cartesian worldview, they would say that, look, nature is an inanimate entity. It is insensate. I mean, so what are we talking about rights for that? But in actually the philosophical worldview of the developing countries, and this has come up very sharply, for example, in the constitutions of Bolivia and Ecuador. And again, you can Google these, where they come up with the concept of trusteeship of the earth. That is, they recognize legal rights of Mother Earth, you know. And, you know, they use actually an indigenous language word for that. but it is enshrined in their constitution. In India, of course, you know, the both these countries, the concept of rights for nature is not at all alien. So on a deep philosophical level, yes. In terms of practical policy, I think that, you know, so far we have not seen that much difference.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, please.
Good morning, sir. Sir, my question is, the green consumer, which you mentioned as a sustainability driver in your slides, sir, is that a myth or a far-fetched reality or a dream, or is it from a utopian world?
Is that a myth? What's the empirical evidence? The empirical evidence is that many eco-labeled products actually get a premium. So if you go, for example, to Fab India and you want to buy, say, green tea, and it says it's organic green tea, and you go to one of the other stores and you get, say, tea which is not certified, consumers there are paying a higher price for the certified organic tea. There is also a lot of empirical evidence that women are much more concerned about the sustainable, about using sustainable products, because there is an association, because women typically are concerned about the health of their children and the welfare of their families, and so they associate a sustainable product with a healthier product, with a less contaminated product. And so the empirical evidence is, yes, there is definitely a lot of concern for, you know, significant amount of concern for sustainability. And you have seen this ad that we have, you know, in the Indian TV, right? So there is this yacht salesman who is trying to sell a yacht to obviously a person who is obviously a billionaire. And he tells him all the features of the yacht and so on, all the luxury features of the yacht. And then this billionaire customer asks him just one question.
Kitna dete?
What does that signify? That person is concerned about you know, the ecological footprint. Anyone else?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay.